Hey everybody, welcome back to the video. Great to see you today. I hope you are pumped for today's video because it has taken us an entire calendar year, 365 days, although with leap year, it's probably like 366 days to make this video because today we are going to do an update for my year of fashion lo-bi, which I had also called it Handmade 365 with the intention that I will be making and sewing more of my clothes rather than buying. So I started this personal challenge in August of last year and we are coming real close to exactly 1 year. I'm filming this at the end of July, but you'll probably see this in the beginning of August. This will also likely be a slightly lengthier video because I do want to talk to you about some of my thoughts and takeaways from this personal challenge. I'm actually going to show you every single item of clothing that I have purchased throughout the last year, which means if you need to go to the washroom, if you need a snack, if you need to get yourself some coffee or some milk tea, whatever that you need, pause the video, go get it now, because we're gonna be here for a little while. I'm super excited to film this video because I think this whole experience has been really telling in many ways. So I've actually got notes, just so that I don't ramble on and miss anything that I really wanted to say. I really wanted to make this a thoughtful video. And for those of you who are maybe considering trying something like this, this might be like a little insight for you as well. So if we like rewind way, way back a year ago, I had started in August, like I said, a fashion, mostly clothing no-buy, with a few exceptions to the rule. Now I also sew, and I sew my own clothes. I'm not great, but I'm not awful either. I'm kind of in that, you know, there's a very long and large chunk in the middle between beginner and you know, getting into advanced or confidence. Like, I'm still kind of there. I'm edging more towards a bit more advanced, but there are some days I just throw my hands in the air and be like, I can't deal with this, you know? So with that said, I wanted to go back and look at what was the premises of the challenge and what were the rules. I'm gonna try to skim through this fairly quickly, as much as I can. So I rewatched my video from a year ago and the premises was to sew as many of the clothes that I needed or wanted to wear as I can. On top of it being a low buy for the purpose of buying less, I wanted to have this motivate my sojo, that's I suppose that we call it in the sewing community, your motivation to sew, you know, build up your skill sets and stuff like that. And I'll touch on how that went throughout the video as well. My exceptions to the rule of the low buy were that I was allowed to buy knitwear and sweaters because I don't knit, I don't crochet, so that's kind of out of the realm of my sewing anyways. I am allowed to buy undergarments. I'm not gonna show you any undergarments I bought as part of the carousel of clothing that you'll see in a second, but I also don't think I bought any new undergarments in particular over the last year anyways. Number three, I was allowed to buy workout wear and outerwear. So again, things that I don't know how to sew and fabrics that I have zero experience working with. And I just didn't want to go there where the technology and the fit and, you know, the waterproofing, like all that stuff really plays a key role in it. I stepped away from all of that. The fourth exception for me was that I was allowed to buy pants with zippers. If they were elastic waist pants, I was gonna make them. If they have zippers, I'm gonna leave those to people who know what they are doing because we're still in a very volatile relationship between myself and installing zippers. So those are my four exceptions to the rule and the reason I had wanted to give this low buy a try. You know, a lot of it, like I mentioned in that video, was about fit. I am petite in stature, 5'2" if you round up on a good day with a little extra hair. And a lot of things just don't fit. It's hard to buy off the rack and have it fit me. another element of this was I wasn't pleased with the quality of the things that I was able to afford, and the ones where I thought the quality was great were like way out of my budget, and the ones that I felt comfortable spending my money on just often wasn't that awesome. Doesn't mean that there's no exception to the rule, but you know what I mean. So let's kind of break down how this all went. I'm gonna start showing you, and hopefully this means I've like edited this, my face is now this way and there's a little pop-up on this side. I'm gonna show you every single piece of clothing that I bought over the last year. I'm not gonna try it on. I know it would have been amazing if I tried it on. I'm just not going to. But if you want to see these being styled or worn, if you got another idea, pop it down below in the comments. We'll get to that on another day. I'm gonna talk you through kind of the 4 to 5 things that I learned, my takeaways, and then I'll answer a couple of your questions, because I put it out there on social media, like, what would you guys be interested in me answering from this experience? And some of you had left comments as well, so thank you for that in advance. So, what did I learn from going on this low buy challenge? Well, it was so good for honing in and really carving out my personal style. Right now, I feel completely confident and comfortable in identifying clothing that are in line with my personal style, and that's a great, great feeling. Because then moving forward, when I go shopping, when I look at something, I can be much more objective and be like, this looks great on the model, or this looks great on so-and-so who's showing it, but it's not part of my style, and I would have a hard time making it fit into my wardrobe. It showed me what I really love to wear from what I had already owned getting into this challenge, and then what I really hated, because then I just never wore them, and you know, I decluttered them. Because if you only had the set amount of things you could realistically wear, you quickly understand what you love wearing because you keep repeating them, and then the things you're just like, you pick it up, you try it on, you're like, yeah, you put it back in the closet, right? You know exactly how that feels, I think. So that was an unexpected result from this experience. I found out what I really loved, and I found out what I really hated, both in terms of my style and also the fit on my body shape. Two, I didn't buy a lot of clothes because, you know, low buy challenge. However, I bought a lot of sewing patterns with the dream, the wonderful dream, that if I have this sewing pattern, it means that I will make it at some point, and it fits within my low buy of, I didn't buy a piece of clothing, but I bought the style in a sewing pattern and I would sew it. More on that in a second. I don't spend a lot on sewing patterns, but I definitely realized I was spending more time looking for sewing patterns, and I do enjoy the thrill of the hunt, you know, don't get me wrong, and I love collecting sewing patterns, I love collecting vintage sewing patterns in particular and retro styles, but I did do a lot of window, I guess, online browsing for patterns, and I bought a few more than maybe I would have, because I'm like, well, I can't buy this in the store, so let me buy the sewing pattern that's very similar to the style that I really liked. I still shopped, but just virtually, and not in a store, and not with an actual piece of clothing. I wasn't, and I'll touch on this in the following point, but I wasn't necessarily inspired to up my skills in sewing, but I felt a sense of comfort that if I have that sewing pattern, this garment is mine, just like in the future once I actually make it up, if you know what I mean. Another thing which surprised me is that I didn't necessarily end up spending my money on more expensive items. So one of the ideas I had a year ago was, well, if I wasn't spending willy-nilly and I was buying much more thoughtfully and, you know, narrowing what I was allowed to purchase, those purchases I could then spend more money on. I don't think that was necessarily true. Of the things that I bought, a lot of them were still within the price point that I would have normally felt comfortable spending on. I didn't necessarily up my budget to buy more expensive items. And when I say expensive, it's with the attachment and the assumption that a slightly higher price point often will mean slightly better craftsmanship, quality of materials, and longer lastingness in your closet. That didn't really happen. I ended up shopping a lot for sales, and then I started shopping Poshmark, which is a secondhand, I guess, personal secondhand retail kind of platform where you as an individual can resell items that are no longer bring you happiness in your closet. And I have a Poshmark closet as well. I'll link it down below if you're in any way interested. I don't put a whole lot on there. It's usually like a lot of shoes. But yeah, this idea of how much I feel comfortable and I find reasonable to spend on clothing remain more or less the same. And I don't know if this is my mentality growing up, you know, as a 1.5 generation immigrant child, that you had to really save and be thrifty, or because I sew and I compare the value of quality of materials to craftsmanship to the final product, I'm very particular and often wary of that. I have spent more than I was comfortable with on a clothing item and have it, you know, get a hole. I was like, what the heck? So that was interesting. I thought I would be spending more money on singular items. I didn't. Another thing, I guess this is point four. What I really missed about just being able to go out and buy something that I liked, buying ready-to-wear, sometimes in fast fashion, is I really missed the colors and the prints. A lot of the fabrics I end up buying, at least in the last year or two, have been beautiful prints, and you know, with patterns and colors and stuff like that. And though most of the time when you see me filming, I'm wearing like a neutral, I am so drawn to the prints and oftentimes limited edition collaborations with other designers have limited edition prints, and it gutted me when I couldn't buy those. I'm like, oh, but it's so pretty, you know, or like it's exclusive, or like it'll be sold out within 2 months and I will never be able to get it again. That FOMO fear when it comes to a print that you really love, that was interesting. Number five, I guess, I didn't actually sew more than I normally would have. Now, full disclaimer, I think the last year, the work year career-wise, has been incredibly stressful, and those who have been following me on my channel, I've spoken about it here and there, and I had a video about that. And then COVID happened, and it all just went downhill from there, right? So with that and other things, I didn't actually end up sewing more as I had hoped and intended to do. I sewed about more or less the same as I did before. I didn't sew faster, I didn't sew more, I bought more patterns, but not a lot of actual more garment sewing was done, which was surprising to me. And I think, you know, I put that down to I didn't want sewing to be stressful for me. Sewing is meant to be fun, it's meant to be like letting my creative juices flow, and of course you feel proud when you make something, but if I had to like sew a t-shirt because I really needed a black t-shirt and I'm not allowed to go and get one because it would break the rules, I would be already almost starting on a negative note and have this pressure to produce this t-shirt that would be up to my expectations. Now, I'm a perfectionist in many ways, and producing that perfect t-shirt would nag at me. When I could sew just for leisure and as a creative hobby, it didn't really matter how my things turned out. I mean, I'd still love it if it turned out great, but if it didn't, it was okay. I could just go and get one off of the store. So that was an interesting result. I didn't foresee, you know, going in that direction, but for sure, I don't think I sewed as many things as I would have liked to. And sometimes when you're tired and you're not in your creative groove, you're not going to sew anything. You're just not. And therefore, I would just wear the same, you know, gray t-shirt. Be like, whatever, it's fine, right? Because you're not in the mood to create. Now, I have a few viewer questions that I wanted to touch on. And again, thanks to those who like to respond and left questions and stuff like that. And if you have any other thoughts or questions or spin-offs from this video you want me to talk about, again, leave it down below in the comments. But somebody had asked during this process, how did I curb the itch to shop? Because I don't think that goes away for a very, very long time. And they asked how to curb impulse shopping, especially fast fashion. So this, I think I would answer this question a little differently than probably the next person. And of course, you know, everybody's got a different opinion. But for me, when I started this, a lot of fast fashion didn't fit me because I'm short, my proportions weren't the fit model proportions, and I speak about this quite frequently in sewing videos. When a brand makes a piece of clothing, they fit it on a fit model, and the proportions of the fit model will differ based on the brand, their target demographic, you know, the generation and stuff like that. A fit model from the 50s, 60s will be different than a fit model now. A fit model is usually they're much taller than I am, and they don't have as large of a cup, like a bust size, cup size. So things just fit funny. So I didn't go into this be like I bought fast fashion all the time or shop all the time. I was always looking for the perfect thing to fit me, but I didn't necessarily buy a lot of things to keep. But the impulse to look and to browse is still there, and I don't think that really stopped. I still looked at fashion a lot, look at the styles a lot, but always with the little, like, you know, little like asterisks in my imagination or in my head that goes, this isn't gonna fit you. And I don't think that part changed at all. Maybe fortunately, maybe unfortunately, with the realization that I'm much more comfortable with defining my personal style and seeing something and knowing that it won't fit into my life and into the way I like to wear my clothes. Another question that came up was capsule wardrobes, how I feel about it, and I guess maybe in a way if I would ever consider doing one. It's funny because in a way, doing this low buy, and like I mentioned, you know, understanding and learning what I really, really loved versus what I really didn't love in my wardrobe, forced me into a kind of a capsule wardrobe situation. I was re-wearing a lot of the same items because either they were functionally what I needed, they either made me feel good, you know, I'm a total practical kind of girl, so things need to be practical. They ticked all the boxes. So in a way, I ended up leaning a bit towards a capsule wardrobe unintentionally. Now, I don't think, here, let me rewind. I could probably very successfully do a capsule wardrobe, but I wouldn't want to because I wouldn't want to deprive myself of being able to get something that I really loved or that I thought was, like, you know, that limited edition print or something that would add a lot of fun and joy to my wardrobe. I wouldn't want to limit myself in that way. And I think this also leads into the question of, you know, what's next after your year of low buy? Would you continue doing this? Would you do it in a different way? And I think I would still be much more conscious of what I was bringing into my closet, but I wouldn't want to be, you know, stuck in a box that I could only get these things because they fit the rules. And I wanted to, in a way, still shop for my style, but shop thoughtfully. And I think that is the biggest and the grand takeaway from this whole experience, is knowing what I like, knowing what I don't like, being much more intentional. I know this word gets thrown around a lot, but I don't know another better alternative word, but really being more intentional about what I bring in and knowing that the things I bring in are going to last, hopefully. And maybe taking the pressure off of having to make stuff, I might actually end up sewing a few of the patterns that I end up purchasing during this time. I'm still looking for a way to really like zhuzh up my sojo, you know, my sew motivation. I am not a fast sewist, it takes me a long time. And often that can feel discouraging because you're working on a project for like weeks and weeks on end without really finishing, and then either being like meh about it or being disappointed about the way that it looks, because I don't like to make muslins, and that's just me. So I hope that you got a little something out of this video. Thank you so much for joining me for a little chat session. If you got questions and comments and thoughts, and what did you, if you watched the original video, here you go. If you watched the original video, I want you to stop for a second, leave me a comment, let me know what you thought the outcome was going to be. What did you think about the items I ended up adding to my wardrobe? Now, a few of them did break the rules, but the majority of them are well within. Would you ever consider doing a low buy like this? What would you suggest I do as a spin-off of this experience? I'm happy to answer any questions and chat with you in the comments down below, so leave loads of comments. Give this video a thumbs up if you enjoyed it. Subscribe if you loved it. Don't forget to hit the notification bell, because that's how YouTube works nowadays. I can't wait to see you again in our next video, and take care. Bye, everybody.